All right, welcome back, everyone. We're going to start our session two of our program. This session really promises to generate a lot of conversation on the critical transportation infrastructure that a thriving agriculture industry requires. But first, I would like to introduce a few more of our sponsors today. We give thanks to the South Dakota Ethanol Producers Association, represented today by Kyle Gilley, who may be out of the room at the moment, but we thank Kyle and the ethanol producers for their support. Thanks to Zoetis, represented by Kathy Mitchell and Paul Fullerton. And also our sincere appreciation goes to First Dakota National Bank, represented by Nate Franzine and his team of finance folks from First Dakota National Bank. So thanks to their support. Roads, rails, and rivers are the essential transportation modes for moving ag commodities and production inputs throughout the heartland of our country. Our panel this morning will bring to light some of the unique considerations for strategic investment in local, state roads, the needs of an effective regional railroad system, and the impact of the country's aging and underfunded inland waterway system and coastal seaports. We have a very dynamic panel with great perspectives to lead this conversation today. Our first panelist will be Jim Schmidt, an elected commissioner in Lincoln County. Mr. Schmidt is currently executive director of the Sioux Empire Housing Partnership. He was born and raised on a family farm near Lenox, which he continues to farm today. While very close to urban development of southern Sioux Falls, Lincoln County still comes in fourth in the state's number of farms. So we know that Lincoln County Commission is dealing with some unique considerations as they consider development of the agriculture industry in their county. As chair of the Senate Transportation Committee, State Senator Mike Valley is very acquainted with South Dakota's road and rail infrastructure. Senator Valley's long career in agriculture and banking sectors have provided him with a very strong business perspective on the transportation needs of South Dakota's farms and companies. In addition to his committee chairmanship, Senator Valley also serves on the Ag and Natural Resources Committee, the Legislative Planning Committee, and the Legislature's Watershed Task Force. Rounding out our panel this morning with perspectives on the nationwide transportation system is Mike Steenhoek from the Soy Transportation Coalition. Mr. Steenhoek leads the coalition's work to promote a cost-effective, reliable, and competitive agricultural transportation system for across the country. Through extensive analysis and strategic planning, the coalition also builds a collaborative partnership with shippers from other industries. Mr. Steenhoek serves on several state and national groups related to supply chain competitiveness, freight, and inland waterways. Gentlemen, welcome to the Governor's Ag Summit. Commissioner Schmidt. Thank you. Your start.
Good morning. I'd like to begin by thanking Secretary Lynch and his staff for offering to South Dakota counties the opportunity to address this Ag Conference and give their perspective on what those commissioners face every single day. You know, I also want to recognize a gentleman who is very instrumental in county government, and that's my boss over there, Mr. Bob Wilcox. And I want to tell you, you know, when politicians get up and they have an ad, they say this was approved, this was paid for and approved by the politician. I want you to know my remarks have been sanitized and deodorized by Mr. Wilcox. So if there's something that I say that is not true or offensive to you, he's the man to blame. That wasn't so bad, Bob. I approach everything, you have to forgive me, with a slight sense of humor. And for the next few minutes, I will try and deliver what I think are some important things. But I have to tell you, I always like to start, because Jim Wooster is a very good friend of mine, And if you know Jim, he always tells stories, and he's a much better storyteller than I am. But I was reminded of one where this gentleman has been told that he has only 20 minutes to live, just 20 minutes. And he thinks, and he said, would you bring my pastor in? And his pastor comes in and said, my son, you have touched my heart by wanting me to be with you for your last 20 minutes of your life. And he looked at the pastor and he said, you know those 20-minute sermons that you give? They went on forever. So hopefully we will have something here. I'm also pleased to be with Mr. Steenhoek, and I'm also pleased to be with Senator Vehle. Senator Vehle has high marks amongst county commissioners because he has fought tirelessly to increase the revenue that counties get to deliver the services that they have to do. So I thank you publicly, Senator, for that, and I'll mention how good you have been to us in a minute. My remarks this morning are going to be, and by the way, I don't have a PowerPoint or a handout. We're from county government. We can't afford those luxuries, so you'll have to listen to me. I was a teacher at one time, and I'd rather look at you rather than having you watch over here. And if I see anybody with a cell phone, I also was a principal, and I see one of those, put those babies away, because I may point you out. My remarks this morning are going to be into three categories. There's going to be one on transportation, then I'm going to talk about the consequences of just saying no, and I'm also going to talk about returning to the 50s. And I'd like to start with transportation because that's what we're going to be speaking on today. Transportation is the lifeblood of economic development. Make no bones about it, everybody would agree. If you can't take your product and you can't get it to its final destination, you don't have a productive economy. And as roads go, so goes your economy. When you look across our country, and farm-to-market roads were mentioned by Secretary Lynch this morning, we have, presently, a very good road grid to do that. But that road grid is aging and deteriorating. It's not like wine. It doesn't get better with age, I'll tell you. And everybody that was at the dinner last night certainly understood that. I mean, about roads and not about the wine. Which consumed much. Anyway, my son is a vice president at Raven Industries. And for a long time, he was in charge of the agribusiness division. He is now in film division, and I bless him well because I tell him, keep working, Anthony, pay that Social Security, your dad appreciates it, all that. He would go to Brazil, and he was in Brazil many times, and he came back from Brazil with a totally different perspective on what is going on and what we have over here. Because he said, they can raise soybeans as good as you can and cheaper than you can, but they can't get rid of them. Their infrastructure is poor. They're trying to get it as good as they can and pouring literally hundreds and thousands of dollars trying to develop so they can get their product to the port so it can be shipped overseas. So while we sit here knowing that that is a problem for them, let's not rest on our laurels because someday they will have an adequate system and they will truly be a competitive for us as we try to compete with them and maybe they have a cheaper price. So I'm looking at just transportation as something that is so critical that we have to maintain our infrastructure. And when you talk about it, it isn't just a local issue for townships or counties or a state issue. It's a national issue. We got to put our arms around this thing. If we don't, we're going to pay an awfully high price for something that we have neglected. It's like anything you have. It's buildings or anything. If you don't put money back into it, you're going to pay a price at some time. So transportation is something that is critically important. And I want to go to consequences of saying no. We live in a time in our right now where we have the no word is probably the most predominant one that politicians all say. And what they say no to is a term I like to use. It's called revenue enhancement, known by any other name as taxes. But somehow they all laugh and they all know what I'm talking about anyway, but revenue enhancement's kind of a term that takes some of the edge off. But today, if you mention taxes, for some reason, it is no. If you listen to people, and this is no offense to our state legislators that are here, because they don't say this, but if you're a candidate running, you're going to do several things. You're going to cut taxes, you're going to cut out waste, and you're going to eliminate that when you get to Pierre or to Washington. If they had done that, those people that were elected to some of those areas, we would never have a problem because it never seems to happen. Gary, that's not you, though. I know you're not in that category, or Senator, or any of the rest of you. Because just thought I'd kind of soothe that out. Don't want to. Anyway, when you talk about revenue, I want to give you a short course on county government, and many of you know this, but if you don't, bear with me. Counties, you know, are a unique institution because when the Constitution for the South Dakota was formed, counties are closest to the people. We're boots on the ground. We take care of the folks. We're in charge of roads and bridges, but we're also in charge of medical indices. We're in charge of rent subsidies. We're in charge of elections. We're in charge of a whole number of things. And when you talk about public safety, we're an organization that arrests them, we try them, we defend them, we house them, and then we pay for them when they're in prison. All of that is done. And we have four sources of revenue, basically. We got property taxes, which you all pay. We have license, registration, and license plate fees. By the way, Senator Vallee gave the counties, through his efforts, $32 million of increased revenue a couple of years ago. Lincoln County got $500,000 of that. So on behalf of all of us, again, thank you. That was the first time. License plates had been raised in I don't know how many years, and you're probably going to talk about that, Senator. But they could do it on a regular basis rather than waiting so many years in between. Now, when I speak of those areas, and then we have a wheel tax. We can go up to $4 on a wheel tax. There are 30 counties in our state that have not enacted a wheel tax. We're not one of them. We have $4 a wheel. I have some real issues, and I know this may not be popular, but I have real issues with counties that do not exercise their right. It's a local control issue. But try to get an enacted wheel tax, and if the citizens say no, well, then the citizens can inherit those kind of roads which aren't up to par. But I don't believe that when the state offers money to counties, that those counties that haven't enacted every possible thing they can do themselves, they're deserving of the kinds of things where counties have been in the lead. The other part is we get some STIP funds every year from our good friend in the DOT, which I see our distinguished Secretary Berquist is sitting back there, and I hope for our mentioning that, Mr. Berquist, that you look kindly on any requests that Lincoln County has in the future. I want to break down our revenue quickly. I mentioned when you say we get revenue from taxes, that tax dollar is broken down this way. Counties get 16 to 17 cents of that dollar, and townships get 4 or 5 cents. Districts like fire and ambulance, and they get a penny. So now you've got, it's about 17 cents there, you got a few cents over for the townships, one or two over there, and the rest of it goes to schools. Now bear in mind, we do this, so we get a dime, a nickel, and 2 pennies to do all the things that we have to do. You know, you talk about Jesus and when he fed the multitudes with a few fish and thousands, I feel like counties do that all the time. The other thing we get to do is when we want to talk about how we're going to raise taxes for next year. Okay, well, prices are up, maybe 6-7%. Maybe counties should want to do that. Local control, maybe we don't. Oh, there is a state statute that says, counties, you have an option. You get to raise your taxes, mill levies or whatever you want to call it, by 3%. Or the CPI, which is ever less. I don't like that word. Less, which amounted to 1.5%. So that's what we got next year to do all the things you got to do at 1.5%. Now I want you to picture this. When you talk about costs, I'm going to give you just some costs. To stripe the roads, this is Lincoln County stuff, it costs $700 a mile. to stripe a road. If you want a chip seal, you know, the windshield breakers, you want to get people call you all the time about their windshields, do that and don't put the signs up. Chip sealing costs between $23,000 for us to $25,000. If you want to do an overlay, that's $120,000 to $125,000. And if you want to reconstruct a road, it's $1 million a mile. I'm not talking about bridges. Counties throughout the state have over 4,100 bridges. 1,100 of them are in disrepair. 73 are shut. Right now, Lincoln County has 17 that are floated off to somewhere in Iowa. You know, we can sit here and whine, and I don't mean to take from my colleagues, but the federal government does a unique thing because they all say they're going to raise the gas tax. They get to Washington, a gas tax for the highway fund is introduced, it gets no, and how do they subsidize that? Well, they take it out of the general fund and put it in the highway fund. The general fund, what's that? Borrowed money. So who loses? We all lose in the long run. Highway funds are going down because of the efficiency of motorized vehicles today. So, which brings me to return to the 50s. Reality for counties is this, and not necessarily township, but counties throughout our state. It isn't east or west, it is the state. What options do they have? Well, they can grind up the asphalt and turn to gravel. When I grew up as a kid, we had gravel roads. That's all we had. And suddenly we got hard surface roads, and I thought, life is good. And it was good, because we have a better mode of transportation. I think by going and grinding roads back to gravel, if it's your only alternative, it's there. But I think it's going backwards. I think if you only have gravel roads in your county, how are you going to attract business and industry and commercial things? How are you going to grow your county's tax base if you have just gravel roads? And I'm not saying that's all bad. If that's what you can afford, that's what you can afford. Roads today, and I want to mention this, agriculture is different. You know, you used to be able to go down the road and you had a tank wagon behind you and you had 75 bushels pulling it with a tractor. Now you've got a tractor, but you've got a wagon behind you that's carrying 800-900 bushels called semis. Or you've got tank wagons that have 600 or 700 bushels. Roads were not built for this kind of stuff. So on it goes. So I'm whining and ranting, and I'll shut up in a minute. But there are solutions out there, ladies and gentlemen. There really are. You're here. You have leadership in our legislature through Senator Valley. We know the problem. We got to find different modes of paying for our roads and infrastructure. And you know, counties can do more. Maybe we can do more collaboration and purchasing and buying. We've tried it, but we haven't done enough. Basically, I haven't given up on Washington to do anything, but I don't look there anymore for any help at all, because I think we need to take care of ourselves. And the bottom line is, you and I are going to dig more in our pockets and pay for roads. I don't know about you, but sometimes I can fill my gas tank and it's $3.50. I can get up the next morning and it's $3.60. And there's no revolt, there's nobody rioting in the streets, there's nobody clamoring to come to the courthouse, you just pay. But I think if you tried and you said, we're gonna raise our gas tax by a dime, you would hear. But it's well worth it, because it's our future, and that's what concerns, I think, all of us, is that we've had the best of times. We leave for our kids and our grandkids the same opportunity that we've had. And we do that by taking care of the infrastructure and making sure that economic vitality is still here. Thank you for the time.
That's kind of a tough act to follow. I just told him that I know Jim Wooster. His dad was my dad's best friend. I come from the large city of Reliance, and they farm just north of there. So my name is Mike Valley. I'm chair of the Senate Transportation Committee. I have been on the Transportation Committee and the Ag Committee 8 out of the 10 years I've been in the legislature. So it's kind of apropos that they're both meeting at this juncture. I'm going to, and also that was part of my business life. My dad ran a grain elevator in Reliance, so I wish I had a penny for every scoop shovel I scooped back then. I'm going to say three things to start with, and I'm going to end with those. The first one is, everybody wants good roads. No one wants to pay for them. The second thing is, if you got it, a road brought it. There's not much that's parachuted in. And the third thing is, if you produced it, a road moved it. Not much is airlifted out. It's roads. Now we'll see how well I can master this thing. First thing, I want to talk to you a little bit about the functional classification of mileage. Sounds big, but I just want you to understand that's all the miles we have in the state of South Dakota. If you look down at the bottom, it's about 83,650 miles of roads in the state of South Dakota. Tells you which ones are interstate and arterial roads. You go over to the next one, and then we're just talking the state roads. That includes your interstates, all your state roads. There's 8,850 miles. You know, sometimes you got to put things in perspective because you go, how big is that? Well, 83,650 miles, that's how many roads we got in South Dakota. If you want to drive on all of them, that's 3 1/3 times around the world at the equator, not at the North Pole. Okay? So that's a lot of roads here in the state. Now let's just talk about the state roads. How many of them? 8,850 miles. You want to drive them all and just check them out? Yeah, it'd be the same thing as driving from New York to L.A., then get in L.A., drive back to New York, then drove back to L.A., and then go back to about South Dakota, 3.6 times trips. That's our state roads. That gives you an idea how many we got. All right, let's just talk about the local roads. There's about 70, right down at the bottom, 74,000 of those. How are they divided up? If you look over there, you got your and the left one, the townships, and the county secondaries. That's one group of roads. If a township is not organized, then those roads become county secondary roads. So that's a large share of the roads. You got the counties, county primary roads. You move over here and you got the surface types. You look down here, about 66% of them are gravel. Then you've got this group up here that's about total of about 17%, primitive, unimproved, and graded. It's about 17%. And then you got some of the paved roads that some of the counties are lucky to have, but presenting a problem. Then you got some primitive ones. So that's how the roads divide up. Let's look at the conditions of our county paved roads, the paved roads. Now, you need to understand that this is a self-assessed survey by the counties. So this is, you know, not they might not all judge the same, so that you understand this. This is what we asked the counties to do, and they came to us with this assessment, and this is the totals from each county. And we got pretty good participation. 57 out of 66 counties responded, and this is what they said. Your overall condition of paved roads, 4.6 out of 10. Not real good. Okay? Failing, poor, and fair. You add those three together and you darn near got, 60-70% of your roads. That's why there's a lot of talk about what the commissioner just talked about, going from oil to gravel. Because the problem is, you know how we built those roads? We started out, a lot of them when we were in the 30s, we took the ditches, dig them up, throw them in the center, put some gravel on it, graded it, and it worked good for the kind of loads we had back then. Let's talk about the gravel roads, county gravel roads. Overall condition a little bit better, 6.2 out of 10. But you still look at that's in the fair, poor, and failing condition, and you got about 56%. So over half of them are either in fair, poor, or failing condition. Now, when that happens, especially this next slide, to get an idea of what we're talking about. That was a paved road, okay? It missed the gravel part and went to dirt. Sometimes people say, well, just put an overlay on. If you don't have a base underneath it, it doesn't do you much good to put the overlay on top. That's what happened. All right, let's talk about bridges. They'd be called structures. the state, and Secretary Bergquist is back here, so if you see him squirming in his seat, it's because I missaid something, so he'll probably give me a chance to correct it. But any bridge that's over 20 feet or longer, by law, they have to be inspected every 2 years. This will tell you where our structures are at. 65% of them are local. Then you have 31% of them are state, and then you got some others that are game, fish, and parks and city. But that tells you where our structures are at. Here's how they were built. Remember I was talking about the 30s? Look down there. Your blue are your county roads or your local roads, and your red are your state. When were all the bridges put in for the most part? 1930s. The 1930s. We had a depression back then. Put in a lot of roads and bridges. Then we had the interstate system come in. You look down there, and if you look, it's about the 1960s. That's where the big state roads or state bridges are coming in. Bridges back then were probably designed for 50 years, so we're pushing it. That gives you an idea where we're at with our bridges. Now, this doesn't look good. Number of structures that are structurally deficient or functionally obsolete. If you look over there, your state roads, you got 9.8%. If you look at your county roads, it's about 32%. And your city roads are 27%, and the game, fish, and parks, of course, you're out in the country there, they're even worse. They're at 52%. But there's not many of them. That's a problem. Now, structurally deficient, though, sounds a lot worse than it is. Doesn't mean that it's unsafe to be on, but it might be posted. The term is when there are elements of the bridge that need to be repaired or replaced. Maybe it needs a new decking. Maybe there are some other things that need to be done. And so it's not necessarily unsafe, but it does need to have something done to it. Functionally obsolete. That means that it might have inadequate water capacity for the current that goes under it, and then they happen to leave and go to Iowa. Might have inadequate vertical or horizontal clearances. But a lot of them are posted. And if you don't follow that posting, this next slide, I thought of Apollo 13. Remember that? And he called in and he says, "Houston, we have a problem." Oops. That's the definition for our functionally obsolete. And these are these on the, can people look at these slides? Can they look them up? Is it going to be posted on the internet? So that's your definition if you need to have those. Okay, now my story. Houston, we have a problem. Now, I don't know the circumstances behind this, but probably could be that tractor has gone over that several times before, you know. And it's probably posted, don't know. But it's no longer there. Houston, we have a problem. Okay, let's look at our state structure, our bridges, health index. We're right at the 90% mark going back to 2003 to 2013. Pretty good. We go into the future, and for our bridges, staying right at that 90%. That's because your DOT has made a concerted effort to do something with the bridges. And that's important, because you can have the best roads in the world. If you can't cross the creek, doesn't do you a darn bit of good. So it's important, and I appreciate the Department of Transportation taking that outlook. All right, so let's talk about a little bit about funding. Let's talk about the feds first. This is the Federal Highway Trust Fund. That's about 18.4 cents. You buy that, you pay that every time you buy a gallon of gas, okay? That goes to DC, and for that 18 cents, they send us back about 36 cents. We get about 2 for 1. The reason they do that is we got a lot of roads and not many folks. So when they designed the interstate system and the federal road system, they knew that they had to do something with those areas that are rural in nature. Because you don't want to have, I-90 happens to be the longest interstate in the nation. You don't want to go from Minnesota to South Dakota and all of a sudden it turns to gravel and it's that way through Wyoming and Montana because we haven't got enough people to keep it up. So that's why they devised that system. Here's what's happening, though. The last time they raised it, 1993. So as the commissioner said, they've been taken out of the general fund. Well, this last year, they put in a new budget policy. And it's not as easy to dip out of the general fund. You got to find some place to save the money. So you'll hear things like, well, we're going to cut Saturday service so that we can put more money. I mean, they're going to come up just because they're going to, you know, what the other guy wants and doesn't want, you're going to go for what he doesn't want so that you create a stalemate again. But here's our problem. In August, it runs out of money. It's gone. So they can't do that because it's illegal. So what they're going to do, I asked the secretary, and I hope I'm not speaking out of turn here, I says, what's going to happen? Well, he says, we don't know. But the rumor mill is, I don't know, how many of you know how we pay for our roads when they're being built? Probably most of you don't know. What we do as the state, let's say we owe you $1 million. It's a two-week time, and we got to pay you, and you got several projects, we owe you $1 million. So we'll use round numbers. The state writes you a check. XYZ Construction Company, $1 million. Then we sit down, we write out a bill, we send it to D.C. for their 80 or 85% share, 90% share, whatever it is. And then they, you know, week 10 days, they put the money in our account. All's well. They're running out of money. So probably what will happen is they'll send us, I don't know what it'll be, say 50%. They'll send us $400,000 instead of $800,000. And they'll send us an IOU for the other $400,000. So I asked, is that IOU any good? Yeah, probably, because you still got that 18 cents, you know, that's coming in, and it'll take a little while to build up. So they'll pay that off, but the next year they won't be spending any money. They won't be authorizing us any programs for us until those are all paid. What happens to our construction? It goes down big time. Now, how big an issue is that? Well, let me just give you an idea. I don't have a slide for this, but I call it the five-legged stool. Where we get our money? $275 million, this is statewide, $275 million comes from the Fed. That's our biggest. Our motor fuel, some people call it a gas tax, I call it a user fee, $131 million. License plates, $96 million. Excise tax, $73 million. Wheel tax, just short of $12 million. That's where our money comes in. What's our biggest one? Feds, our friends in D.C. So that is huge. They don't have the intestinal fortitude to raise the funds for it. That's one of my worries, is that they'll take it from someplace else. And how are you going to, they're saying we're going to have a different accounting measure for some type of investment thing. Well, how do you know what that is every year? You don't. And so what you need to do is you need to have a specific funding module that sends that money in, and you know how much you got to work with. Okay. What's our pavement condition on our state roads? The last time we raised the gas tax and the excise tax was 1999. This is where we were back then. We had 9% poor and, where is it, 21% fair. I look at those two, because when a road is in poor condition, you got to dig it up and start over. So let's see where we're going. And I've got to skip ahead here a couple. Got out of place. Now we're going to compare with where we're at today and where we're going. That's where we're at today. We got 2% poor. That's all we have today. That's really great. And only 9% fair. Probably some of the best conditions we've ever had for roads. At the same amount of revenue we have today, both state and federal funds, those numbers I just gave you, they keep on the same track. Here's where we are in 2024, 10 years from now. 25% of our roads are in poor condition. 1 out of 4 miles in the state road system's got to be dug up and done, and redone if we put no more in than what we're doing today. So if you think gas tax or any other revenue is high now, if you wait till that 10-year period, you're going to have a real problem. Now I'm going to go back. I'm going to go back to this chart. So how come all this, it's going to happen in 10 years? Why did that happen? If you remember a few years back, I had a bill to raise the gas tax, raise the excise tax, and raise the license plate fee. We did eventually get the license plate fee. What happened? I was short three votes. I'll never forget that. I was three votes short in the Senate. I got one that said he had changed his vote. I had one that said, if you find the third one, let me know. And I never could find that third one, and I tried. But it's the way it goes. Why haven't I been saying anything for the last 4 years? We had a recession. It's hard to raise a tax in a recession. But number two, remember the stimulus program? We got $183 million. And we didn't have to match it. We didn't have to put in our 20%. That makes it worth about $220 million. That was a big spike. I don't think in 5 years we're going to get another one of these stimulus money. Now, we can complain about the stimulus funding all we want, but the ones they put into roads, I'll contend, was a pretty good idea. Because one, you had to do it anyway. We have to fix our roads, right? And number two, they says, well, we're going to have to borrow to do it, so our kids are going to pay for it. Kids are going to use the roads, too. So there is some benefit. Probably make some enemies when I say that. But I think that was probably a good use, and if we'd have used more of it that way, it would have been better. That's what they did back in the 30s. The cost for clunkers, that'll probably go down as not a real good idea. Okay, so now that we know that, we know how we got into this position, what's the cost to get us out of this? How far does $1 million go? Well, if you're just going to put an asphalt overlay, you get 4.5 miles out of your $1 million. And if you're going to redo it on a rural roadway, you get about 8/10 of a mile. If you're going to go put it in a city, you just fall short of a quarter mile when you got to redo it. Now, so what's it cost to keep them up? The numbers aren't on here exactly, but you can see it costs you less to keep up an excellent road than it does a good road. And then if it falls in the fair condition, it costs you a lot more. And the poor is less. Everybody says, why is that? The reason is you've given up on it. You just say, we're going to do enough, we'll patch it enough just to get by till we can afford to dig it up and start over. All right, I'm going to drop that right now. So what I wanted to do was just give you an idea of where we're at. Don't have any solutions yet, because some of you may know, we have what we call the summer study this year. It was the number one issue by the legislature, which I was surprised. I proposed it, and it became the number one issue, and that's what we're doing. We're studying that issue, and that's where a lot of these slides are coming from. Let's talk about railroads. Extremely important to South Dakota. And I want to go back to the years in the mid-80s when the Milwaukee Road went broke. We bought those railroads. And you know where would we be today if we hadn't? We've got a north-south line that goes all the way from Sioux City all the way up to Aberdeen. We wouldn't have that. And the line that goes from it goes down to Aberdeen, splits there in Mitchell, goes over to Canton and up to Sioux Falls and out, and the other one goes down to Sioux City. Now we've just put money into the line going out to Chamberlain, and we had a bill that I was fortunate to get through with a lot of help from a lot of people, including, well, I lost him here right now, but Mr. Schmidt. And we're waiting on a Tiger grant. We're going to use that, hopefully, even to get it as far as Presho. But right now what we want to do is we want to make sure that we can move stuff by rail, because that takes it off the road. And that's extremely important in South Dakota. In fact, this next one shows you how much is moved by rail. Just to give you an idea how much grain was moved by rail, I got to put things in perspective. If you took all the grain that was moved by rail and you put it onto semis and you put them nose to tail and you started at Sioux Falls and you went all the way to Rapid and you left them parked like that, it would go 9.5 deep. That's how much grain we moved by rail. I think it was 2 years ago when I got those numbers. So that's a lot of grain that didn't totally go by road. You got to have a road to get it there, but it didn't totally get there. I'm going to put in a plug right now for those meetings. We're having regional meetings on roads, local, state, anything to do with roads. First one is in Yankton on July 1 at 11 o'clock. 11 till 2, or 11 till 1, I think it is. The second one is up in Sioux Falls that evening, 4 to 6. The next one is July 2 in Watertown. and that's at 11 till 1. We're doing these over lunch hours so people can get to them. In the afternoon, we're up in Aberdeen, 4 to 6. We go to the 23rd, I think it is, and we go out to Belle Fouche, 11 o'clock in the morning, and then Rapid City at 4 that afternoon. And then obviously we have our meetings in Pierre. We got one in August and another one in November. So what I wanted to do is I set them around so everybody is basically within 2 hours can get to one of those meetings. And I encourage you to attend. We've got a couple members that are on that task force here today, and I want them to hear you. Because some of them don't have any idea. We've got some people that are from the metropolitan areas. They do not understand rural problems. They need to hear it from you. They don't need to hear it from me. They need to hear it from you. You need to go to those meetings. Make sure someone is there and tell them what the issues are. And I'm also going to have a sign behind me, and it's going to say problems, and then it's going to say solutions. When I was in business, I always said, don't just come to me with problems. Come to me with solutions. Be thinking in that way. And then remember what I said I was going to do. I was going to say three things. Everybody wants good roads. No one wants to pay for them. If you got it, a road brought it. Not much is parachuted in. And in South Dakota, you know how much stuff we take in and out on roads? $55 billion. How important is that to South Dakota? It's huge. And if you produce it, a road moved it, because there's not a whole lot that's airlifted out. So roads are extremely important. Tell your legislator, if we come up with something, and I can't tell you what it's going to be, you know, first of all, we got a committee of 15, getting them to agree. Then we got to convince the other 80 that's in the legislature. And then there's a gentleman called the governor who's going to be speaking to you. And I want to commend the governor because he came out recently and said he's willing to look at options. And that's what he needs to say, that he's willing to look, because he doesn't know what we're going to come up with, but he's willing to look at options, and that's what we need to do. As you can see from this, it's vital to South Dakota. So with that, I thank you, and when we come up with, you might not totally agree with it, but support your legislator. Support them when they do this. Because we're not all going to get what we want. But we're going to have to do something. So support them in that effort. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Senator Valley and Commissioner Schmidt. I appreciate it in your comments. One of the topics that you broached, and I'll share a little bit further as my slides are getting brought up. This talking about the competitiveness of U.S. agriculture being so much a function of a transportation system, and talking about his son's experiences in Brazil. Whenever I give a presentation, this slide quite frequently works its way into the program. What you're seeing, and some of you in the back may have a hard time making it out, but what this slide does is it shows the cost of producing a metric ton of soybeans from three locations: Davenport, Iowa; Sioux Falls, South Dakota; and North Mato Grosso, Brazil. And for those of you who aren't acquainted with the global soybean industry, the U.S. and Brazil are number one and number two in total production, and Mato Grosso state is the number one state, soybean producing state in Brazil. And so as you can see, it not only talks about the cost of producing that metric ton of soybeans, that's expressed in farm value. And as you can see, in this particular case, it actually costs a little bit less to produce that metric ton of soybeans in Brazil compared to those U.S. origination points. Sometimes the U.S. is a little bit less expensive, sometimes Brazil is less expensive. But what really screams out at you at this slide, and that's why it's highlighted in red, is the cost of transporting that metric ton of soybeans to a customer in Shanghai, China. When you look at a field of soybeans in the United States right now, you can assume that half of what you are looking at will be consumed outside the United States. One quarter alone will be consumed in China. So it is very much an international industry. And as you can see, the cost of transporting soybeans is significantly less for U.S. originated soybeans compared to Brazil. Why? Well, because we have the opportunity to take advantage of the more cost-effective, reliable modes of transportation, particularly the inland waterway system. If you're located in close proximity to the Mississippi River, the Illinois River, or the Ohio River, those are the three main navigable waterways in the United States, particularly for agricultural products. So for Davenport, that's going to be about a 900 to 950-mile journey to an export terminal down in southern Louisiana. It's loaded onto a vessel, about a 30-day journey, goes through the Gulf of Mexico, Panama Canal, across the Pacific Ocean to a customer in Shanghai. For the Sioux Falls movement, that's going to be about a 1,400 to 1,500-mile journey to the Pacific Northwest. Among port regions in the United States for soybeans, about 60% of soybeans are exported out of the Mississippi Gulf region. 25%, number two, is the Pacific Northwest. So the Pacific Northwest is very consequential to the viability of our export program, particularly for states like North Dakota, South Dakota, Minnesota, Western Iowa, Nebraska, Kansas. It's predominantly going to the Pacific Northwest. And for Brazil, they, as I said, they don't have a very sophisticated transportation system. You know, I often like to describe agriculture in the United States as trying to attach a garden hose to a fire hydrant. You know, we've got this robust production due to the productivity of the American farmer, but we're trying to attach a more primitive transportation system to it. So it's kind of analogous to attaching a garden hose to a fire hydrant. In Brazil, they're trying to attach a drinking straw to a fire hydrant. They have a very primitive system. I've had the opportunity to be down there and to see the real, the poor quality of the roads. They haven't developed a real freight rail infrastructure. Even though they have very navigable waterways, they haven't really provided that linkage to their navigable waterway system. So in short, what this slide tells you is that the reason why the U.S. soybean industry, the U.S. soybean farmer, is the most economical on the international marketplace is not due to a lower cost of production. It's due to a lower cost of transportation. We talk a lot in this country about out-competing other countries. And oftentimes that discussion is centered on innovation. We just need to out-innovate. We need to develop a better mousetrap than other countries can. Well, there's certainly good reason and justification for that, but sometimes out-competing the rest of the world is not a function of out-innovating. Sometimes it's simply a function of out-delivering. Taking a product that can be produced elsewhere and getting it to our customer in a more cost-effective, reliable, and competitive manner. And that's really the secret to the success of the U.S. soybean industry and agriculture. So, because of the importance of transportation to the profitability of the American farmer, the decision was made in 2007 to create an organization focused exclusively on the transportation system that serves rural America, called the Soy Transportation Coalition. And I'm based out of the Iowa Soybean Association office, but I'm accountable to a group of 12 state soybean associations, including the South Dakota Soybean Research and Promotion Council. And so I actually have a farmer from South Dakota, from Garrettson, South Dakota. His name is Stan Hansen, who is one of the farmer directors that I'm actually accountable to. So we're a farmer-funded, farmer-led organization. So transport, you know, and a lot, unfortunately, historically, a lot of these soybean farmer and just more broadly agricultural organizations, they've really spent so much of their time focused on stimulating supply or stimulating demand. But I think the case increasingly needs to be made that you have to have connectivity between supply and demand. Otherwise, supply and demand just looks at each other. And they don't have that agreement doesn't come to fruition. And that's what we're simply focused on. You know, unfortunately, I think the United States can be described as a spending nation, not an investing nation. And there's a big difference between the two. And I provide this infomercial a lot of times about agriculture, particularly to urban audiences, because I actually have the opportunity to speak a lot to more transportation-oriented groups that really don't have much experience or knowledge of agriculture. And I'll say, you know, some industries create the ripple effect, other industries ride the ripple effect. And I think agriculture is one of those, and is an example of one of those industries, perhaps the best example, of the stone being dropped into a pond, and it creates the ripple effect that so many other industries benefit from and rely on. And so then the question is posed to the audience, you take away, what happens if you take away the rock? You take away the ripple effect. You take away the businesses that benefit from that ripple effect. And so we have the opportunity in this country for agriculture to provide a long-standing, perhaps permanent, perpetual competitive advantage for the United States and for this particular state. But it depends upon us regaining that investment mentality and foregoing that spending mentality that very much permeates and dominates Washington, D.C. and many other places around the country. You know, perhaps the elephant in the room issue on transportation in general, particularly surface transportation, is how do you pay for it? And we talked about the, you know, the fuel tax, and there's this wide recognition of the need to improve our surface transportation system, but we keep getting, we can't get off the dime of how do you pay for it. One of the big problems facing the United States in general and a lot of individual states is that we have a fixed source of revenue for the United States. It's an 18.4 cents per gallon tax on gasoline. And for a lot of other states, you have a fixed gasoline tax, 22 cents in South Dakota, trying to meet the needs of an escalating cost. And even the most fiscally conservative anti-tax zealots would concede that the cost of concrete, steel, labor, and equipment goes up over time. And if you're practicing good stewardship, there should be some kind of relationship between cost and revenue, but we don't have that. And so we have this system that it may not be intentional, but the outcome is inevitable that you will have funding shortcomings, that you will have funding gaps. Again, a fixed rate of fixed revenue trying to meet the needs of an escalating cost. That's what the result is going to be. And so, but again, you have a lot of people, a lot of stakeholders, a lot of policymakers who acknowledge that problem, but they will say, if I'm going to try to remedy the problem, I want to try to provide some kind of concession, even though, albeit a modest one, to the taxpayer. I'm uncomfortable with the prospect of when being acquainted with the need of just simply saying, taxpayer, you solved the problem. We're going to push this problem onto you. Unfortunately, we live in a world, we live in a political world, where elections are won or lost based on sound bites and headlines. And if we had, I like to say this, if I had the opportunity if I had 10 minutes, maybe even 5 minutes, with any voter talking about the need to invest in your infrastructure, I think more often than not, I could be persuasive in for them to understand the need for increasing a fuel tax. Unfortunately, our elections are not conducted that way. The conversation isn't conducted that way. It is conducted via sound bites and headlines. And campaigns are won or lost based on that. And so the fact of the matter is when you have, not in all of occasions, there's a lot of elected officials who are very forthright and say, hey, we need to do this, and they haven't been punished for that. But there's a lot of examples of elected officials who have been. And the question is, can some of these proposals be distilled down to that one headline? You raise taxes on hardworking Americans during a time of economic anemia. And the times always justify the excuse. You can say, you know, this is not, our economy is in the doldrums right now. This is definitely not the time to be raising fuel taxes on hardworking Americans. Economy rebounds, you can say, our economy has finally emerged from the doldrums. This is definitely not the time to be increasing fuel taxes on hardworking Americans. The times will always justify the excuse. And so, that being, for that reason, we decided to conduct a study, and we hired Indiana University to crunch the numbers, in which we had them look at the ramifications on a national level and on 12 individual states that comprise the Soy Transportation Coalition, so including South Dakota. if you did two things. Number one, if you immediately decreased, with a D, decreased the fuel tax by 1 cent, and immediately indexed that fuel tax to inflation. Again, back to my earlier point, there's a lot of elected officials I've interfaced with. They understand the nature of the problem, but they're uncomfortable with saying, I'm going to vote for that unless I can provide some kind of concession to the voter. And I think, in my opinion, when you craft a legislative strategy, you have to ask two questions. Number one, what should be done? Question number two is, what can be done? And sometimes the answer to those questions, and I would say more often than not, the answer to those questions are quite different. And so this is a strategy that really is focused on what can be done. I look at it this way, since I work in transportation, I ask the question, what is the load carrying capacity of Congress? What is the load carrying capacity of the insert state legislature? Is it to do something very ambitious? 10 cents increase fuel tax per gallon? If the load carrying capacity of Congress can do that, then by all means, let's promote that. If the load carrying capacity of Congress is not that, though, shouldn't the strategy be crafted accordingly to what the load carrying capacity of Congress is? And that's what this strategy actually is focused on. Some key findings. So we're in the process of releasing this. It's not even on our website yet. But we'll have a series of individual briefing papers, 2 to 3 pages each, for the federal government, but then also the 12 states that comprise the Soy Transportation Coalition. But here are some key findings for the state of South Dakota. If you did that, immediately decrease the fuel tax by a penny and index to inflation, you would have a reduction in gasoline, a reduction of state revenue by $6.7 million in 2014. If you then indexed, and then number two is if you did that, it would result in an additional $9.9 million in average annual tax revenue between 2014 and 2025. And then in the year 2025, the state would have 25.9 additional dollars of revenue by that year. Had South Dakota indexed fuel taxes to inflation in 1999, the last time there was an adjustment to it, an additional $436 million would have been generated through 2013. One of my favorite comment quotes is from an author by the name of Karen Lamb, and she said, "A year from now, you may wish you had started something today." And I think when I look at that third bullet point, I think 5 years ago, or in this case, it was 14 years ago, don't we wish we would have done something like this? A year from now, don't we wish we would have done something today? Looking at it this chart shows what, I saw some of the revenue estimates that Senator Valley gave, and they're slightly different, but they're generally in the same ballpark that our researchers came up with. It shows four columns: that current tax revenue, the status quo if you did nothing. Column number two is if you did this proposal, the 1 cent reduction in fuel tax, and you index it to inflation. Column number three is the additional revenue that you would be generated on an annual basis. And then number four is that cumulative change under that proposal. The 2 years that are wanted to highlight are 2016 and 2018. And in the year 2016, the research that we conducted shows that the annual revenue generated under this proposal, 1 cent reduction indexed to fuel tax, would exceed the annual amount generated under the status quo if you did nothing. Now, for the years leading up to that, you still have some cumulative loss, so you're kind of you're still kind of in the red. And then the question is, at what point do you recover that loss? And what we project is the year 2018, where you've recovered that loss, and then at that point, from that year on, you are in net positive territory, growing with each succeeding year. And one of the reasons why some policymakers that I've talked to about this concept, why they're attracted to it is because they like the thought of just kind of essentially putting it on cruise control. And then, now it's not, given fuel efficiency of automobiles, there's going to be a time where the gas tax is not going to be sufficient to meet our needs, whether you index it or not. But the prospect of some long-term sustainability is an attractive concept to them. So moving on. So more information about that. If you want some of more the detailed information about South Dakota, please see me afterwards, and I'll make sure you get that information. Moving on to rural infrastructure. I like to describe agriculture as a 21st century industry utilizing an early 20th century rural infrastructure. Consider all of the progression and evolution within the agricultural space over the last 50 years, from the seed that's utilized to the machinery that's utilized to how it's marketed to where it goes. Think of all of that innovation, but yet it's relying on a rural transportation system that, to be honest with you, is very reminiscent of what my parents would have experienced and observed growing up on farms in central Iowa in the 1950s. A 21st century industry utilizing an early 20th century rural infrastructure. Late last year, we released the results of an analysis in which we looked at this incompatibility between what modern agriculture needs and what our rural infrastructure is able to provide. And we have a bunch of state profiles, and this is from South Dakota, showing a lot of things. Number of farms in 1950, 67,000. Number of farms now, less than half. The average farm size, though, went from 669 acres to 1,300 acres, 1,374 acres in 2010. Volume, this is bushels of all agricultural products, 152 million in 1940, 920 million in the year 2011. So you have this system, this rural infrastructure system, that clearly was not designed or created with modern agriculture in mind. And there's some real incompatibility between it. And so then the question is, well, what do you do about it? And we're introducing some thoughts that are very controversial, and we knew it going forward, but the worry that we have is what's the solution that you're holding out for, that some windfall of revenue comes and rides in on a white horse and saves the day, that the federal government wins the lottery? What is the solution? And so I think that it's very appropriate to start asking questions. Well, would we be better served if you had fewer miles of high caliber infrastructure versus a glut of low caliber infrastructure? Would that actually serve agriculture better if you did something like that? Very controversial, because as soon as you go from the theoretical to the practical, you start getting people to say, well, not my road. And I understand that. What we want to do with this analysis is to really try to foment a discussion in which you have county government, you have farmers getting around the table and really asking the question, given this progression, this evolution, what is our rural infrastructure in this county or this locality need to look like 10 years from now? What's our strategy? Do we have one? And what are the things that we need to do incrementally in year one, year two, year three, et cetera, to get to that point so that 10 years from now, what we're actually utilizing is more compatible with the needs of modern agriculture? Wouldn't that be a healthy discussion versus, and I criticize some of farmers a lot of times. They'll shake their fist at county government and say, why aren't you doing a better job of taking care of our roads and our bridges? Well, the fact is that counties are cash strapped. And this is not a statement of opinion, it's a statement of fact that the rural infrastructure was not built and designed with semis carrying 900 bushels of soybeans. That is a statement of fact. But how do we get around that? How do we have a productive discussion? And that's one of the things that we're really trying to encourage with this research. And so things like taking roads out of inventory and maybe transitioning them to productive farm ground. I mean, there's a lot of things that we're trying to discuss. Again, very controversial, but a discussion that needs to happen. We talked a little bit about bridges. I mean, this is one of those rankings where if you're at the top of the list, you're at the bottom of the list. This is the U.S. This was recently released by the U.S. DOT. Number of states ranked by percentage of deficient bridges. You see my home state of Iowa, number 3. South Dakota, number 4. 21% of bridges rated as structurally deficient. And historically, whenever I was acquainted with that data, my assumption always was that there was a very science-based, objective process of arriving at those conclusions. This bridge is rated poorly, this bridge is sufficient. But what I learned is that the approach, while it has served the American people well, you don't have bridges crumbling left and right, and we have a very safe system, But the process which is employed, which is a visual inspection process, can be quite subjective, and the results can vary from states to states. And I was quite skeptical of that when I first heard about that, but then it really became more intriguing to me when I visited with an engineer from the South Carolina DOT who's using structural health monitoring equipment, which is kind of placing sensors on bridges and doing test loads and really understanding, have a clear understanding of what the true condition of that bridge is. And he told me an occasion where he had 15 bridges that he examined, 15 rural bridges that were load restricted, load posted, and after testing those bridges, he was able to remove load postings from 5 of those 15 bridges. And the consequences of that are twofold. Number one, a detour that had caused some hardship to the utilizers of the system. A farmer, if you have a bridge that's taken out of service, what's normally a 5-mile journey can easily become a 15, 20, 25-mile journey if you have one bridge that's out of service. So it removed that inconvenience and that cost from the utilizers, from the farmers. And then number two, it allows the counties to more appropriately manage their resources, because we all acknowledge that there's a problem. We all acknowledge that resources are scarce, but shouldn't we, when resources are scarce, shouldn't we make sure that we have the diagnosis right in the first place? What frustrates me, I used to work on Capitol Hill in DC, and what always frustrated me about the federal government is when acquainted with the problem, let's just throw money indiscriminately at it without making sure you have the diagnosis right in the first place. And what we've done in short is we have reached out to the 12 DOTs that comprise the Soy Transportation Coalition, and we offered to help underwrite the cost, so farmers putting their money where their mouth is, the cost of them doing this type of testing of rural bridges in their state, which will hopefully result in better decision making. So this discussion is in varying degrees of progression in all these various states. We actually have a project that was completed in Iowa late last year. We were invited this past February, I and the lead researcher from Iowa State University. We gave a presentation to the House Transportation Committee at the State House in Des Moines and talked about the real compelling results of that. Three rural bridges were evaluated. We did this evaluation. Load postings on those three bridges were removed. And so, again, is there a way of continuing to practice better stewardship? The solution is not always, government, you need to write a bigger check. Sometimes you can practice better stewardship as well. And this is one of those projects where we aspire to do that. And I'll go through these last few slides quickly, but freight demand for trucking, you have a demand for trucking on the increase, but yet you have supply that's not keeping pace with that demand. Miles of public roadways have only increased 4.5% since 1980. We're still continuing to have a persistent driver shortage. So availability for drivers and the roads is actually not meeting the needs of our keeping pace with our demand. So we think it's reasonable to be open to opportunities to get more out of the system, extract more capacity of the current system we have. And we're talking about expanding semi-weight limits from an 80,000-pound 5-axle configuration to a 6-axle 97,000-pound configuration on federal roads. I know in South Dakota you benefit from a heavier allowance on your state system, and I think most would agree it works quite well, but we would like to see that increase occur on the federal system. One of the things that our research has shown and other research shows is that there's a much stronger correlation for motorist safety. From a motorist safety perspective, there's a much stronger correlation to the density or the number of semis versus the weight of individual semis. And so you can actually, by promoting this, you're proposing a system that will have less density than the status quo if you kept a threshold on semi weight limits, which will result in a lower probability of an accident. And there's a lot of data to substantiate that. This is something that's going to be discussed as Congress reauthorizes or thinks about reauthorizing a highway bill that they're supposed to by September 30th of this year. Shifting to rail. Rail is a very significant problem. Ground zero is North Dakota, but you're really seeing the ripple effects of that in South Dakota, Minnesota, Montana, in parts of Iowa, where you're having, obviously the severe winter that we had this last year. The amount of snowfall and the amount of ice, that was pretty detrimental, but even more so was the actual cold. and the number of days that were below zero, below negative 15. And you know, when you have persistent low temperatures, you have to, railroads have to do things like shorten the length of their trains from like 7,500 feet, which is pretty typical of a unit train, 110 car unit train, down to 4,500 feet because of the performance of the air brakes. You have to limit the weight and the length of that configuration. So you're having fewer cars per locomotive. That ratio diminishes. And so as a result, turn times are going to be diminished. When it gets to be really cold, you have mandates that will kick in that for every minute, every 30 minutes that someone works outside, they have to have like a 20-minute warm-up period. So all of a sudden, just the efficiency of the system is just gets to be really gummed up. So winter undoubtedly had a real detrimental impact on performance. Then also, you know, moving forward is this supply-demand imbalance. You know, and particularly for the rapid growth of crude oil in this country. In 2009, you had 11,000 carloads of crude oil shipped by rail. In 2013, 400,000 carloads. So you have a real supply-demand imbalance, and there's this concern that agriculture is getting squeezed out of that. We talk a lot about trying to find ways to stimulate greater investment in our rail sector. We don't really have a regulation problem, in my estimation. We have an investment problem. In any way we can make rural America a more attractive place for investment, the better. Last couple slides. If the inland waterway system is not particularly or acutely relevant for South Dakota agriculture, but I think there is a prospect for it to get more important to the industry here. We, in particularly because of the expansion of the Panama Canal, that right now it looks like it'll be completed in early 2016. They're going to be expanding it so they can accommodate larger ships. We did some research to ask the question, what's the ramification of that expansion on agriculture? And our research shows that total grain and oil seeds transiting the canal will increase by 30% by the year 2020, 2021. Each vessel will accommodate an additional 500,000 bushels of soybeans. A typical Panamax vessel, the maximum ship that can go through the current Panama Canal, is loaded with about 2.1 million bushels. So 500,000 additional bushels of soybeans is substantial, about a $6 to $7, sometimes $8 million of additional value per vessel. And last slide is, there's going to be a potential for it to have a favorable impact on South Dakota. By being able to load these ships down in southern Louisiana heavier, it will make the mode of transportation that feeds into it, barge transportation, more economical. And what that's going to do is it's going to expand the draw area on either side of our navigable waterways to the river. There'll be a stronger incentive to move via truck to the river, loaded onto a barge terminal, at a barge terminal onto a barge. Right now, it's about a 70-mile draw area. If you're 70 miles or closer to the river, barge is a very viable option for you. But after the Panama Canal is expanded, we could see that expand to 161 miles if you're loading what's referred to as a small Cape-sized vessel down in southern Louisiana. And as you can see, it's going to be pushing that draw area back. Is it going to really overlap on a lot of South Dakota? No, not very much. But one of the things that we see and observe is when you see a region have more options, more freight options, barge, rail, truck, versus just one, rail, that has a downward effect on rail on freight rates in that area. And so the more you move that draw area closer and closer to places like South Dakota, it's going to have a favorable impact on rail rates, because that will mean that railroads are less in the elevated negotiating position with their customers than they currently are. So we think that could be very favorable. So with that, appreciate your time and attention. Appreciate allowing me to join you today. Happy to answer any questions. Thank you very much.
Well, one thing I know for sure, when you talk about raising taxes, people will have questions. So I think we're going to take a good bit of time here. We have about 15 minutes. Would really like to continue the conversation. What questions do you have for folks after hearing these presentations? We've got a microphone back here. Anyone willing to offer up that first question? I have one while you think of of your own questions. Commissioner Schmidt, the role of local governments to provide that immediate stakeholders, the residents of your counties and townships, those services. Could you talk more about how you work as a county commission with your township boards, particularly as we know a lot of emphasis in South Dakota has been on developing and siting new livestock facilities, any kind of new project on the local infrastructure, which requires some expansion or upgrading roads, bridges, culverts. Could you maybe reflect how you work with your partners in the township on those projects?
We take pay a great deal of attention to our townships. There are some that have the opinion that townships, you know, don't really do a lot, but they really do a tremendous amount because they are the basic road grid that sets everything up. We have a joint meeting as much as we can on a regular basis with townships and try to listen to what their specific needs are and how county can help them deliver them of the services they have. One of the things that we, and I'll just tell you very quickly, right now we have the situation in Lincoln County where they've had we have had really a major disaster because I think our township roads throughout the county are going to be they're decimated. I've driven on them, and one township has come up with that they're going to have about $250,000 worth of repair. That particular county has about $47,000 in reserves, and that what I mean by that is that's the cash they have on hand to pay for their maintainer to pay for this. So what we're trying to do is to listen to each one of them to prioritize how can we deliver to them. Can we sell gravel to them cheaper? Can we provide them culverts cheaper? So it is kind of a mutual thing that you try to work together on this thing. One of the things that our townships are facing is, and I think of townships throughout the state, they're going to have to prioritize roads. Because townships cannot afford, they can't maintain it on 4 cents. You just can't. I don't care how you cut it. So what they have to do is, I introduced this to a township board meeting once, and I said, what happens if you had to prioritize your road? Do you, every, on you know, a township being 36 square miles, do you have to have a road on every section? Do you have to have that? Can you prioritize those roads which are the highest? And then townships come in. I'll tell you one other thing. You mentioned, I think Senator Valley said, when they were built in the 30s. Well, you got some of these things that were built by the WPA. And, you know, I mean, you got a road that's about 12, 14 feet wide, and a guy comes along with a 30-foot head. What does he do? Well, if he can, he'll knock the sides off, and then you won't have anything, and which has been done. But having said that, we have worked hard with them to put those box culverts out of there. I'm babbling here, I know, but we try to communicate as much as we can to listen to what their needs are so we can reflect that back in our budget, because townships are really hard pressed to keep their those gravel roads done. And I don't know if I totally answered your question, but we talk to them as much as we can.
Questions, one here with Tammy and one here in the front.
Yes, I have a question regarding soybean transportation and the increased use of barge traffic. How is our waterways, do they need dredged, or are they going to be able to have the capacity to take these barges?
Well, the system is you know, it's kind of unfortunately a common theme that we're dramatically underinvesting in that system, that, and the inland waterways is a great example. You know, fortunately, a sliver of good news is that Congress recently passed and the President signed a new Water Resources Reform and Development Act that it basically provides the authorization or the strategy for how you maintain and invest in your inland waterway system, including ports. There is the prospect for pretty substantial increase in additional revenue for our ports, and that big beneficiary are going to be these export terminals down in southern Louisiana, but you know, some of the, even some of the ports in the, on the West Coast, Grays Harbor, Washington, lots of South Dakota soybeans go there, and that's an example of a port that needs to be dredged, and so there is the prospect of additional funding for our port infrastructure. A very modest increase in funding for the actual navigable waterways, the inland waterway system, our locks and dams, and so it's woefully inadequate. And one of the things that we've talked about, Soy Transportation Coalition, we've done some research on this, and some people have said it's a very compelling idea. Other people have said, Mike, you're waving the white flag. you're capitulating. Is that the statement that I make is that a predictably good inland waterway system is better than a hypothetically great one, okay? And what that means is if resources are going to be scarce or on the decline, which that's what my crystal ball says, and if someone has a different, if the crystal ball of someone else says something different, that hey, we're going to have this windfall of money, I will be happy. But I've not found someone who's identified that yet. So if that's the situation with revenue, wouldn't it be better to first take care of what you have and then try to acquire what you don't have? And that's what we're talking about with these locks and dams. So the good news about locks and dams is that they're not like cell phones. You know, what you purchased 10 years ago is obsolete today. You know, lock technology has been basically the same for 150, almost 200 years, okay? And so if you just do a good job of maintaining it, you can dramatically elongate the useful life of it. The best example is the Panama Canal. The current Panama Canal is built in 1914, older than most all of our locks. And if you ask someone from the Panama Canal Authority, after you expand the canal, what's your plan for the current Panama Canal? They'll look at you almost like you're with a puzzled look on their face, and they'll say, well, we're just going to keep using it because we keep maintaining it. We take care of it. And so, I mean, you've got gates, you've got a concrete chamber, and you've got valves. And if you just simply take care of them, you can dramatically elongate the useful life of it. So I think that we need to prioritize, take care of what you have, and then if money becomes available, then you try to acquire what you don't have. And I think that message is really resonating more and more, but we've got a long ways to go. The problem is, as these structures deteriorate, we get closer and closer to a catastrophic failure. If that happened during harvest season, it would have a real cataclysmic effect on farmer profitability.
I don't get another question here in front.
Yeah, I was interested in a similar topic. Essentially, you talk about the prediction of increased use of Panama Canal and the barge. You had the discussion about the Brazil viability transportation-wise and so on. How dynamic is your prediction, and does it include all of those different factors, the ongoing viability of the locks and dam system and so on?
So mainly just how viable is that prediction on increased use of that draw area after the Panama Canal? Well, it's an inexact science, and so you've got all these variables, but it really just kind of asks the question. One of the things that people in the freight industry, particularly with agricultural freight, they pay a lot of attention to is the freight differential of shipping off the West Coast, particularly the Pacific Northwest, and shipping out of the Mississippi Gulf, okay? They constantly monitor that. And it's usually about $30 cheaper to ship off the Pacific Northwest to Asia than the Mississippi Gulf. It's a longer journey from Mississippi Gulf, so that stands to reason. It's cheaper to get it to the port in Mississippi than it's cheaper to get from via rail to the Pacific Northwest. And so it's about a $30 differential. And as that shifts, it will favor the Pacific Northwest or it'll favor the Mississippi Gulf. And what our calculations, it kind of worked off of that dynamic. And if all of a sudden you're loading these ships more with soybeans or corn for that matter, in southern Mississippi on the river, that's going to have a favorable impact on that rate, that freight rate going out of the Mississippi Gulf. And therefore that will allow people increase the willingness of incurring increased cost driving to the river because it's eventually going to get cheaper. So that's what that's really based off of. And I think the math is pretty solid. I've been happy to see, we did this research a couple years ago, and just in the last 6 to 8 months, saw Rabobank. They issued a study about asking that same question. They cited our research. They had a map that's very similar. The U.S. Maritime Administration, they did a similar study, cited our research in it. So, you know, it's great when you can sing off your own song sheet. It's great, even better when others are singing off it.
I think we have time for one more question. I know one right over here. We've got lots of fingers pointing at me. We'll go here.
Senator Vehle, your summer study committee, can you give us an idea of is gas tax, the increase of gas tax, is that the only option? What other options are being talked about? I mean, counties and townships can opt out. You've got red fuel. There's a number of other options. I'm just wondering how much, what are the other options you folks have talked about?
Well, and we're just getting started on that. We had our first meeting about a week ago. And the gas tax isn't the only thing that's out there. And just so you understand, though, it's at 22 cents. And the value of that in 99 at 22 today is worth 10.8 cents. So it's less than half of what its buying power was in 99 than what it is today. So but that's not the only thing that you can look at. There are other, and that's what we're doing in this next meeting that we're going to have in August. We're going to bring in NCSL, which is the National Conference of State Legislators, and hopefully also CSG, which is the Council of State Governments, and have them talk about what other states are doing. There's no sense in reinventing the wheel. We had part of that in testimony earlier this year in committee, and it was really enlightening as to the different ways that people could look at it. I mean, there's, like you mentioned, you could look at dyed diesel is a thought process. You can look at, there's all kind. I mean, some people like the wheel tax. The wheel tax, the problem is it doesn't raise a lot of money where you need it. In a lot of rural areas, it's not very well populated. If you're over in the commissioner's neck of the woods, you got a lot of folks, so $4 a wheel raises a lot of money. If you're in Aurora County, it doesn't raise much money. Okay, you could, and 46 out of the 66 counties do have a wheel tax. And 31 of those have it at the max at $4. So it isn't, I mean, there are some that aren't, and there are some that have tried, and it's gotten reversed by the people. So we're gonna, and if you got different ideas, that's what these regional meetings are. And I really encourage you to come and say, here's some ideas, because that's what we're looking for. And I don't wanna, you know, I start enumerating them, then we're gonna have a lot of, but there are a lot of different ideas on what we can do in the rural area. I think I'll leave it at that. One thing I will add, you know, we talk about the license plate fees, and we raised them recently, you know, and there was a study, 5 years ago, and it showed, and you can agree or disagree with the numbers, but it said that counties needed about $80 million more a year in order to keep their roads in the condition that they need to be in. I think that one was just to keep them at the current status that they were in then. Well, we raised $30 million with a license plate increase, and you know, some of us caught a lot of grief. I wrote this down so that you all get an idea, and just because someone else has a higher fee or a higher tax doesn't mean we got to do it for that reason. But just so you put it in perspective, even with it raised, this is a Ford 150. Okay, I figured that would be a good one for here. South Dakota, $108. North Dakota, $142. Iowa, $320. Minnesota, $366. Nebraska, $519. Wyoming, $570. And Montana, $1,046 to license your vehicle. So at $108, you know, it's still not that bad, comparatively.
Well, very good. Thanks for the questions. Thanks for the great perspectives. Let's give our panel another round of applause. It's certainly, you know, to Senator Vehle's reminder again about these upcoming transportation meetings across the state. when these are issues of concern in your township and in your county and across the state, participating in this conversation is as important as complaining. If you don't offer your input, try to help with the creation of solutions, we won't be making forward progress. So please visit with your local officials, attend these statewide meetings, and certainly make those calls, send those emails to our congressional members, because they need to hear from you about what's important back here in South Dakota. So with that, we conclude session 2.